Okay, so here we begin. This is lecture 27. Okay, and the previous lecture we saw, I gave you a simple example of, took a very simple case of a channel, and we derived all the three types of equalizers we've seen so far. So just the MLSD, linear equalizer, and DFE, zero forcing. Both of them, and then we calculated the figure of merit, looked at what the structure was, and then tried to conclude something. That's what we tried Saturday morning. Since the vast majority was not here, maybe you missed out on it, maybe you should go back and look at the lecture. Okay, so anyway, so the final, I have one final comment before we proceed. The MLSD and the match filter bound actually were equal, and that worked out to 4 times 1 plus alpha squared by sigma squared, right? So the channel I took, you remember, was what? 1 plus alpha z inverse. Okay, so it's a first order single zero model, the simplest model you can have for FIR. Okay, and then the zero forcing linear equalizer worked out as what? 4 times 1 minus alpha squared by sigma squared. Okay, and then the DFE worked out as 4 by sigma squared. Okay. So three different ways of dealing with ISA, and we got three different figures of merit. So the question now is, how do you define SNR? Okay, so that's an important question. So what do we think of SNR always? Signal to noise ratio, some signal power in the numerator and noise power at the denominator. Look at the match filter bound and MLSD. Okay, so if you look at the transmit power, what is the transmit signal power? Expected value of the BPSK constellation. Okay, so that works out to something like 2 or 1, okay, so which is just some constant, okay. But if you look at the received signal power, how does the received signal power work out? Roughly as, 1 plus alpha square, right? So it's not equal to the transmit signal power, okay. So there is some confusion there, okay. So this extra 4 times 1 plus alpha square causes some confusion in the definition of SNR, right? If you define as just 1 by sigma square, then it looks like ISA will be better than the non-ISA, just BPSK, no ISA case, right? There the figure of merit was 1 by sigma square, right? Suddenly you're getting 4 times 1 plus alpha square in the numerator, okay? So it looks like there is some confusion there. So you should be careful about how you compare ISA and no ISA case, okay? So the trick is to define a suitable SNR for the ISA case, which nicely captures both the situations. Okay, you also don't want to do receive power as the signal. That's one possibility, but turns out that also is not the ideal case. There's something else you have to do, and maybe as you learn more digital communication in the future, if at all you do, you'll learn more about how to define SNR properly for this, and then for comparison across ISI and non-ISI. Okay, so that's the point I wanted to make before we proceed. Okay, so far we've been always looking at a channel model which is SK going through an MZ and then noise being added. You get ZKs and you go ahead and process ZK with your detector. Okay, so this we assumed was monic causal loosely minimum phase. And NK we assumed was, right, white Gaussian noise. Okay, so far we made that assumption. All these assumptions were made possible by the crucial choice of the front end. Okay, what was that front end? Front end, which is kind of invisible in this picture because this is an equivalent model, was what? The whitening match filter. Okay, so first you had a match filter, which is a filter whose response is H star of minus T, just completely exactly matched to H of T, which is the received signal, right? And then you have a whitening, which relies on spectral factorization of the power spectrum of H of T, okay? So if you can do both of that, well, the folded spectrum of H of T, okay? So you do both of that, then you get to a model like this, okay? So for this, we know how to do at least three different types of equalizers of varying complexity. And maybe we can be happy about that, okay? So, but in practice, people hardly ever use such models, okay? So, why do you think something like that is happening? I'm sorry? Okay, so time varying is a problem. Suppose I say time varying is not a problem, then what do you do? Okay, time varying is definitely a problem because in most systems things change with temperature, day or time of the day, etc. So many things change, right? So you can't expect to hold everything a constant. But supposing maybe I can deal with it differently. Any other problems? Okay, so first problem is knowing h of t. Okay, so that's got to do with time varying, but even otherwise, knowing h of t exactly, knowing the channel exactly. Maybe you don't want to know the channel exactly. Okay, so you want to put some other front end. That's one thing. Other issue is, several cases h star of minus t may not be that implementable. Okay, so if you think of a rational z transform for h of t, right, you expect h of t to be causal and stable, right? Right, am I right? So what will happen to h star of minus t? Yeah, it's going to be anti-causal and IAR that too, right? Because even if it has zeros, it will only have a finite number of zeros, and once you do h star of minus t, it's going to go anti-causal and IAR. Okay, so there's no way you can implement it exactly. You're going to be only able to implement an approximation to that. Okay, so because anti-causal IAR filters, you cannot implement. It doesn't work. Okay, even if you delay, it doesn't work that well. I mean, ultimately you have to stop. Okay, so that's one problem. Okay, so those are the problems we want to highlight with the white and match filter front end. First problem is with MF itself. Okay, h star of minus t may not be known at the receiver, or maybe it's varying with time and you can't change it very easily, and maybe it's not implementable for so many of those reasons. Okay, so this can cause problems. Okay, so that's one level. The other problem is the whitening filter. Okay, so in cases where you can spectrally factorize, maybe you whiten. Okay, so maybe there'll be cases where you cannot spectrally factorize and you can't keep doing that over time, right? Every time h of t changes, you can't change your spectral factorization and all that. All those things might be difficult. So whitening is also an issue. Okay, so both of these guys are sometimes serious issues. Okay, that's one thing. The other thing is, usually if your front end is going to be analog, okay, at some level, you want to keep it as simple as possible. You can't expect it to suddenly change response, and all these things are tough to do, right, in analog way. So you want to keep the front end as simple as possible and do everything else in the digital domain as much as possible. Okay, so that's why you might want to simply have what's the simplest front end you can think of. What would be the simplest possible front end you can think of? Okay, some low pass filter, right? So your band of interest, you have a low pass filter, that's it. You don't want to do anything more as far as front end is concerned. You do that and then you sample, then do whatever you want in the digital side slowly. Okay, so that's what you might want. So you might want to deal with an equalization model with different front ends. Equalization model with a non-WF front end. Okay, so that's the first step we're going to do to move towards a more general equalization model as opposed to just a WMF front end. Okay, suppose it's not there, it's more general, what do you do? Okay, but I don't want to do it in gory detail with continuous time and all that. I want to still have a symbol time model. Okay, symbol rate sampled model. Okay, I don't want to have anything which is non-symbol rate sampled. Okay, just to keep things simple. Maybe later on we'll have a better model, but we want to still keep it symbol rate sampled. Okay, so this will give you enough flexibility in the design. You can study various type of structures and then come up with more general equalization methods for a different situation than when you assume a minimum phase M of Z. Okay, that may not be always possible. The other criteria is, other important thing is zero forcing criteria. Okay, the zero forcing criterion may not be the best. Okay, so we are already seeing some trouble because of that. At least in linear equalizer, we saw that the zero forcing criteria causes a lot of problems. In case there is a zero for your response, you just can't, it's not stable, right? It doesn't work. Okay, so some serious problems with the zero forcing criteria, and also it causes noise enhancement. Okay, so your variance of your noise at the slicer is going up. Okay, so we saw it in the example also, how it's causing problems. Okay, so because of that, the zero forcing criteria may not be important. So you might want to have other criterion for deciding, for designing your equalizer filter. Even in the linear equalizer, the filter, instead of trying to knock out all the ISI, maybe should do something else. Okay, so those are other criteria that you might want to do. Okay, so all these things we'll try to explore in a more general equalization model setup, which is what we're going to do next. Okay, so let's try to move towards that, such a model. It's quite simple and similar to what we did before, except that I won't do spectral factorization. I won't assume my receive filter is matched. Okay, so those are the two things which we won't do. Let's see how to come up with the model for that. Okay, so it's not too difficult. So let's see what we have. Okay, so at the transmitter end, we still have a sequence of symbols that you want to transmit. It goes through, let's say, a general transmit filter. Okay, so I'll say GT of T. Okay, this is the transmit filter. Okay, and then you go through a channel C of T. Of course, this is the complex baseband equivalent. And then you have the complex baseband equivalent noise N of T. Okay, and then I have the received signal R of T. Okay. So I'm going to imagine a situation where the receiver maybe doesn't know H of T or doesn't want to do matched filtering. Okay. So in that case, the most general thing that one can do is put a general receive filter, GR of T. Okay. Okay. So for instance, a low pass filter. Okay. Just put a low pass filter. Just in general, it will work. Okay. And then you sample at signal rate. So this is my model. Okay. At symbol rate, you sample, okay, and you get, I'm going to say you get ZK here, okay, this is what you get, and I want to build a discrete time model from SK to ZK, that's what I want to do, okay, so all these things of continuous time is what actually happens. I want to have a discrete time model from SK to ZK, okay. So, see, once again, it's easy to do. The first thing that suggests itself is to look at the convolution of all these guys and call it H of T. Okay, so look at what I'm calling H of T. This is very different from the H of T we had before, right? We stopped here for the previous H of T. Now, I'm going to simply convolve the received guy also and then call the overall response H of T. Okay, so if you want to think in terms of frequency domain, HF is going to be GTF CF GRF. That's the Fourier transform. Okay. Okay. So before the sampler here, how can I write the symbols that are coming out? Okay, so it will have two components, right? One component that comes from the signal and the other component which comes from noise. Okay, so if I want to write the signal here, it's going to be this noise going through the receive filter, and then the signal, how am I thinking of the signal in continuous time? It's an impulse train at every t seconds, right? So that gets convolved with the overall response H of T. Okay, so delayed the impulse train when convolved is going to be H of T delayed. Okay, so after that you sample at KT. Okay, so if you put all that together, I can write ZK very easily as SK H of T minus MT. Okay, so remember, this is my signal component before the sampler, right? Now what am I going to do? I'm going to sample this at KT. Okay, and to this some noise gets added, right? Remember, this is N of T going through a receive filter and then being sampled. Okay, so I'll call that some NK. Okay, so I have to figure out some PSD for this NK. We'll do it. I mean, it's not a big deal, but it's some noise process NK. Okay, remember, all of these guys are complex. It's complex processes. Okay. So it's quite simple. Okay, so let's start with the signal part. Okay, for the signal part, right? So if I substitute t equals kt here, right? It actually becomes sk h of k minus mt, right? So I can write that as a, can I write that as a convolution? I've written it happily as a convolution. Okay, so I made a mistake here. It's sm, no? So that's what I thought. Sorry. That's what I thought is a problem. Okay. So sm here, h of k minus m t. Okay. So now if I think of my h of t sampled at kt as a discrete time signal hk, okay, then I can write zk as convolution of sm and sk and hk. Okay, so it's always confusion. A discrete time convolution of sk and hk plus nk. Alright. So you can see that very easily here. So you put kt here, it becomes k minus mt. Okay. So once I sample, k minus mt actually becomes h square brackets k minus m. So it's sm h k minus m, which is exactly the convolution you have between sk and hk. Okay. So that's in short my symbol rate model. Okay, so I have a symbol rate model now. Okay, so the question is, what is this HK? Okay, this HK now we'll imagine is a general discrete time response. Okay, so both sides, because both the causal side and the anti-causal side, it's got zeros, poles all over the place. Okay, so that's how we'll imagine HK to be. Okay, so let's do a little bit more work here just to make sure we understand what this HK is in terms of HF. Okay. So let me write this model once again. Okay, so remember, finally we have zk going through hz, okay, and then some noise getting added to it to obtain zk. Oh, sorry. Seem to be very sharp today, so let me see. Alright, so what is this Hz now? Okay, I have to take Hk and do Z transform to get Hz, right? Right? So if I think of DTFT or evaluating the H of Z on the unit circle, then I can write that as the LES spectrum of HF that I had before. Okay, so that's a nice way of relating everything, getting it together. Okay, so H of e power j 2 pi ft, okay, as in h of z evaluated on the unit circle is going to be what? The 1 by t LES spectrum m minus infinity to infinity of hf. Okay, so because I sampled, the aliasing will happen. Okay, there will be no square term here. Okay, so I can't say h of f is going to be non-negative real, right? Previously I did a match filtering, so I got non-negative real response at the input to the sampler, and then when it aliased, I definitely knew I am going to get non-negative real. Now that assumption we cannot make about this H of Z. H of Z restricted to the unit circle is not going to be non-negative real. Okay, it's going to be in general some complex quantity. Okay, so I don't know what it is. Alright, so it depends on HF what it is. Okay. So that's one thing we can't say. Okay, what about NK? What can we say about the noise process NK? First of all, what is the distribution? Will it be? It'll be Gaussian, right? It'll definitely be Gaussian. See, it's white Gaussian noise, continuous time noise. That's what we assumed. It's going through a filtering. Definitely it's going to be, then sampling, it's going to be Gaussian, there's no problem. But in general, we cannot assume it is white, right? When can we assume it's white? Okay, so when the receive filter satisfies Nyquist criteria with rate 1 by t. If it satisfies that, then I know my NK will be white, right? That's the thing, because GR of t and GR of t minus KT will be orthogonal. So it becomes an orthogonal projection for noise. Okay, but we may not want to even make that assumption. Why make that assumption? We need not even make that assumption. We'll say it's a general low pass filter, in which case we can only provide a PSD. What will be the PSD here? Okay, once again it will be 1 by T aliased. The reason for the 1 by T aliasing is because of the sampling. Okay, and then the original PSD is what? The input PSD multiplied by mod GR of F squared. Okay, input PSD is N0. Okay, the reason why I don't put the by 2 is because it's complex. I'm going to say it's N0. So it will become N0 1 by T aliased mod G of F minus M by T squared. Does that sound okay? Alright, so that's my PSD. Okay, so in general, I'll say my NK has PSD, which is say Sn of Z, and its restriction to the unit circle is Sn e power j theta. Okay, so this will be a PSD, some power spectral density, and my filter is H of Z, which is a generic, if you want a rational model, you can always take rational models, so without too much of a problem, you can take a rational H of Z. Okay, so this will be our general model for equalization. Equalization. So you notice couple of important changes from the minimum phase model, which was H of Z would be minimum phase in that case, and N of K would be white. Okay, and you know that's an optimal way of doing things. Here we don't know anything about optimality. It's just doing it because we want something that will work. Okay, without too much of detail, just to work. So we'll assume. Alright. Any questions before we proceed? So notice the subtle change in the way we have modeled it. It's not anything great, but one thing I want you to be convinced of is, when if at all you actually get to build a communication system and you're doing a symbol rate sampling, you can always model your samples as the transmitted symbols convolved with some discrete time impulse response plus NK. That's always true. There's nothing that will go wrong there. Okay, so it's always true. So that's what we are doing. Okay, it makes sense even at that level. Okay, so that's what's happening. Okay, so the H of Z now, it's like I said, it's taken to be rational typically. So if you draw a pole zero plot, okay, remember it's an actual physical response of actual devices that exist and actual physical channels. So it can't be crazy. Can't be crazy in the sense it can't have poles on the unit circle. It will become unstable. You don't expect real actual systems to be unstable, right? So if you draw the unit circle and draw poles and zeros, okay, one more assumption you can make is real systems are not going to be anti-causal again. Okay, so if you're building something, you can also expect that it will be causal. Okay, if at all there are things outside the unit circle, it will only be zeros and there will be only a finite number of them. Okay, so remember once again, let me remind you quickly about this ROC and all that. For stability, you always need ROC to contain the unit circle. And if you have poles inside the unit circle, your ROC is going to be ring, including the unit circle and outside, okay, the largest pole and everything outside. If you have poles outside and you want the system to be stable, then you can't have a causal thing. So you have to stop somewhere and then kind of come back in, so it will give you both sided, right? And poles outside, so they're going to give you both sided response. So that's the picture you have to keep in mind, okay? So when I say H of Z is a real actual response that you see in practice, mostly the poles and zeros will, well, zeros can occur outside, maybe, okay, a finite number of zeros can occur outside, but the poles will definitely occur inside the unit circle, okay? So maybe there will be zeros on the unit circle, okay, but definitely there won't be poles on the unit circle, okay? So these are very realistic assumptions that you can make about H of Z, okay? And your equalizer or any signal processing you do beyond that has to respect that kind of a model. You can't build something which won't work within this model. Okay, so this will be roughly the kind of thing we'll be looking at. So basically poles are inside the unit circle. Of course, you'll also have this pole at infinity. Okay, where does this pole at infinity come from? You write everything in terms of Z inverse, you put Z equals infinity, things can go to zero if you don't have anything at Z equals 0, right? So poles at infinity always happen, and likewise zero poles at 0 also sometimes happens because of the way you do it. Okay, those things I'll generally not worry about, because that doesn't cause any causality or stability problem. Okay, zeros can be both inside or outside unit cell. Okay, so in any case, whatever model you have, the ROC has to include the unit circle. So if you have poles outside, it's going to be IIR anticausal, which is very, very unreasonable to expect in a real system. Okay, so this is the picture. Okay, so if you want to write H of Z, so another thing I'll do is I'll drop this H of Z. The reason is sometimes I'll want to talk about the Z transform, and equally well it will apply when you restrict the Z transform to the unit circle, right? So if I just write H, it can be both H of Z or H of e power j theta. Sometimes you'll only define it on the unit circle. Okay, you don't care about what happens outside. You can do analytic extensions and all that if you are interested. Okay, so in general we'll take H to be, okay, so you can say, you can argue out that it will have to have a form like this: H0, which is some complex constant, times some z power r, which is some general delay to adjust for all these things, times a minimum phase component. Okay, the minimum phase component is going to include all the zeros and poles on the unit circle, inside the unit circle, and then the maximum phase component, which is going to include all the poles and zeros outside the unit circle. Likewise, I'm going to say, obviously this, there will not be too many poles, there won't be any poles outside the unit circle, but anyway, like the H max, times H0, which is going to be the zeros on the unit circle. Okay, so this is how we can split it. These two terms you can conveniently not worry about. A complex constant and a delay is not going to affect any of the signal processing you do later. Okay, so this is a minimum phase component, includes poles and zeros on the unit circle. Okay, this is going to include zeros outside unit circle. Okay, so it's going to be what? So once you have only zeros outside unit circle, that's going to be, so this is going to be an FIR part. Okay, there are no poles, it's only numerator. Okay, so it's going to be FIR, and then this is the zeros on unit circle. Okay, so in general H can be written in this form. Okay, so about the noise spectrum, we won't make too many assumptions. Simply SN of Z is the noise spectrum. Okay. Okay. So in general, this will be omitted. Okay, so we'll omit this. Okay, without any problem. If at all it causes any problem, it's only a delay adjustment in your receiver. You can always do that. So several samples of delay. And even the constant we'll ignore sometimes. It can be there, may not be there, it's not a problem. Okay, so this is our model. Okay, so for this model, one of the first things to try to do is the zero forcing linear equalizer. Okay, so that's the first thing we'll try to build. We'll try to build a zero forcing linear equalizer. Okay, so it's very easy to build a zero forcing linear equalizer because you know exactly what to do. What should you do? Okay, so what's the model for this? You have noise adding, then you have ZK. What does the zero forcing linear equalizer do? You put a filter here, I'll call it some D of Z, such that the output of the filter does not contain any ISI. It has contributions only from the kth term, kth symbol, and then you slice. Okay, you make decisions. Okay, this is what you do. Okay, no ISI here. So clearly, what's the choice for D of Z? 1 by H of Z. Okay, so that's going to be 1 by H max, H min, H zero. Okay, right? So you can see I've omitted some things, so I'll put a tilde here. Okay, So if you have to implement the zero forcing linear equalizer, right, what are the various filters you have to implement? You have to invert a minimum phase filter. Is that easy? Yeah, that's true. So it will work. There's no problem. Poles and zeros inside, you invert it. Everything is perfectly fine. You can nicely do it. How about inverting H0? It won't work. It's going to be unstable, right? So once you put 1 by H0, it's got zeros on the unit circle, and 1 by H0 is going to have poles on the unit circle. So for the ZFLE to be stable, H0 has to be equal to 1. Okay, you cannot have anything else. Okay, so for stability, clearly you need equals 1. Okay, so no zeros on the unit circle. The moment you have zeros on the unit circle, the zero forcing linear equalizer goes out of the picture. Okay, so you don't want to implement that. Okay, and then what other problem can you imagine? H max inverse is also going to cause problems for you. Okay, the reason is Hmax is a FIR filter with zeros outside the unit circle. So when you do 1 by Hmax, for stability, you have to make it anticausal, but what? IIR. Okay. So what does anticausal IIR mean? I mean, you can't do it. It means infinite delay, right? So unless you do infinite delay, you can't do it. Okay. And since that these two are, I mean, these are zeros that are going to be anywhere. So you can't really control how your impulse response will be. You can only approximate Hmax inverse. Okay, so Hmax inverse is a problem and you can't implement very easily. Okay, right, you can see the, see, it's got zero, Hmax has got zeros outside the unit circle. So when you do 1 by Hmax, all those things will become poles. Okay, and your ROC is going to include the unit circle, which means for any possibility of implementing, ROC has to include the unit circle. So if you do that, you'll see you will get anticausal IIR filter. Okay, anticausal IIR is pretty much ruled. Okay, it's tough to do these things. Okay, so you can't implement Hmax inverse. Okay, so in the only way in which zero forcing linear equalizer becomes implementable is when H is minimum phase. Okay, or maybe loosely minimum phase here and there, but even there is a problem. So it was only minimum phase. Okay, so you go back into your old picture. Okay, so you're not able to get out of the old picture. Okay, so that's one problem. On top of that, even in the old picture, you're going to have noise enhancement, right? So the noise that you see at the input of the sampler, the variance is going to be larger by the arithmetic mean of 1 by the power spectrum that you had. Okay, so that's a problem, power spectrum of the receive filter. Okay, so that's a problem you have to face. Okay, so both of those are serious problems with the zero forcing linear equalizer. Okay, so what we're going to do next is to change the criteria. Okay, instead of doing zero forcing and expecting zero ISI at the input of the slicer, we'll say we'll allow for some ISI, but we'll modify the criteria. We'll try to minimize it in a different way. Instead of only throwing ISI to zero and living with all the enhanced noise, we'll try to minimize something else, which is a combination of both ISI and noise. Okay, and maybe we'll get an implementable filter. Okay, maybe we'll get better figure of merit. Okay, those are the things that we'll go after. Okay, so that criteria happens to be mean squared error. Okay, so our MSE, as it's called. Okay, so there's lots of reasons why mean squared error is really, really popular. Okay, many people use this in so many different areas as a criteria. Okay, so you might say, why look at things like mean squared error? Why can't we just look at the important metric that we are ever worried about? What's the only metric we are really worried about, ultimately? Probability of error, right? So that's what you care about. You don't care about mean squared error between any of these things or anything like that. You only care about one thing, which is the probability of error at the output of the slicer. I don't care about anything else, okay? But we'll see. Probability of error is not really that calculatable. On the other hand, mean squared error can be calculated very easily at the risk. Okay, so I'll point out. So that's why there's lots of practical advantages to it, and it's really, really popular. Okay, so let's see how this is defined. It's a very simple definition. Let me remind you what our model is once again. Our model is SK going through H of Z, and noise gets added. Okay, so we are still in the linear equalizer model. So I'm going to say, I want to put some filter here and then get an xk and run it through the slicer. Okay, I'm still going to do that. S hat k. Okay. But instead of trying to design d of z such that xk has no ISI for every term, I'll try to relax that constraint. I'll change the constraint. The constraint I'll be looking at is this mean squared error or MSE, which I'm going to define as the expected value of sk minus xk. Modulus square of sk minus xk. So it makes sense, right? So the output, you want the mean square error between the input to the slicer and sk as to be as small as possible. Okay, so if there's no noise, then this will be no noise, no ISI, this will be zero. Okay, xk will agree exactly with sk. So it works out perfectly right. Okay. But one thing I want to quickly remind you is this is not the same as minimizing probability of error. Right? Probability of error is some other expression, some nonlinear, not even square, some weird expression, q and all is there, right? So it's not a very direct, simple expression. Okay. You don't know how to think of that, but this is just mean square error, which might be an equally good metric. Okay. So this is the first thing I want to talk about. The next thing is, where did this expectation come from? Okay. So expectation should be over a certain distribution, right? Okay. What are the random things that I have here? Okay. So I'm going to say both SK and XK, I will think of as random processes. Okay. So far in the equalization problem, I've been thinking of, you have L symbols, which you actually transmit and you receive all your ZKs and you're trying to process it and decode a S hat. So you might have thought SK is a fixed length L sequence, but I'm going to, in the model to calculate expectation, I'm going to say the expectation XK, and SK will be also a random process. Okay, random process, but each SK is actually a random variable with alphabet what? Alphabet X, it's the same X. I won't change all that, but I'll simply say it's a random process. In fact, the most standard assumption to make it is what? IID uniform. Okay, so we'll say IID uniform is the most, in most cases. But watch out for this, I'm just throwing it to you as the simplest possible assumption. In fact, later on, if you do some advanced studies, you'll see this IID uniform assumption will be relaxed. Okay, for some reason, we won't see it. But for ISI, it turns out you might want to relax that assumption. You might want to put some further filtering to condition your symbols. But that's different. For our purposes, mostly in this course, we'll assume IID uniform for our SK model. Okay, and XK, of course, I mean, once you have NK itself, XK becomes a random process. It's no problem. But in addition to NK, SK also is a random process. So XK becomes a random process just by definition. Okay, so I'll say it's an induced random process by all these other things and the definition. Okay, all right. So the expectation is over the joint distribution of all these guys. Okay, so that's the way you do it. You'll see in practice it'll work out in a much easier way. Don't be too confused about it. Okay. So that's the main thing. Okay. So to simplify this, we'll define an error process, which is what? What is the error random process? Ek, which is sk minus xk. Okay. So I think it's usually defined as xk minus sk. Let me be careful here. Yeah, it's defined as xk minus sk. So let me be consistent. Okay. This is my error process. Okay. So the MSE in terms of the error process has a simpler and nicer interpretation. Okay. Expected value of mod E of k squared. Okay. So if I think of it in the spectrum domain, how will I define MSE? It's the area under the power spectrum of EK. Okay. So if you think of EK as having power spectrum SC e power j theta. Okay. MSE becomes what? The arithmetic mean of SC. Is that clear? Okay, so once I do that, MSE becomes the arithmetic mean of SC. Okay? So usually, if at all you want to accurately estimate SC, the MSE, you're going to use the spectrum domain. Okay, so you can't try to find the joint PDF. You can find it. It's more confusing, more integrations involved. Okay, so if you do the spectrum approach, it might be much easier. All right, so this is EK. Okay, so our goal is to minimize the area under SE of e power j theta. Okay, so you want to design your D of Z so that this is minimized. Okay, so I want to comment, we'll comment more about how to go about doing it and all that before that, but before that I want to make an important comment. Okay, so this MSC is computable at the receiver. Okay, so that's why it's most useful. So how would you compute it at the receiver? Any ideas? Some approximation only, I mean not the exact computation, but an approximate version of the MSC can be computed at the receiver. How will you compute an approximate version of the MSC? S hat of k, right? So that will be a very simple and nice way of computing ek. So I'll put a question mark here because this is not guaranteed to be equal to ek all the time, but assuming your system is kind of working reasonably, it's going to be equal to ek most of the time. And so if you compute square, some square of ek here, that's going to be a good estimate of your mean squared error. Okay, so whether or not you know sk, you can compute the MSC at the receiver. This is a very crucial reason why MSC is used all the time, or some version of difference and some error notion is used all the time. It's because you can keep track of this guy and see every time this error is blowing up, what does it mean? Something is wrong with your equalizer. So you'll know all these things. So these kind of things are very crucial at the receiver. Now, instead of MSC, if I had said probability of error, how do you compute probability of error at the receiver? It's not that easy to keep track of. You should know SK. Okay, so usually in communication systems, there's a training phase where you know what SK is. In that training phase, you can keep track of probability of error. In fact, in the training phase, you can keep track of the exact MSC also. Even probability of error can be kept track of. But if you are in the decision directed phase, which is after the training phase, everything has to be controlled by what decisions you make at the receiver. Okay. So actually it turns out in today's complex systems, there are some decision directed ideas which can help you keep track of how well you're doing even without MSC and all that. But at the heart of it is all assumptions like this. You compute your decision directed error, then use MSC, mod square and all that. Without probability of error, you can nicely keep track of how well you're doing. Okay. So those are the practical advantages. We wanted to quickly comment on these things before we proceed looking at how to minimize the error. Okay. So let's see. So let's go about doing it. So it's a question of just finding SC. Okay, you find SC and look at the error and try to minimize SC. That's what we're going to do. Okay, see, remember SC is non-negative real on the unit circle. So if you minimize SC at each point, you minimize the arithmetic mean as well. So that's what we'll be doing. Okay, so it's a straightforward thing to do, except that the expressions are a little bit nasty. Okay, so what contributes to SE? Suppose I have to evaluate SC. Okay, so let me cut and paste my model here so that you have a picture of the model ready. Oops. Okay, so here's a model. So ek is what? Ek is xk minus sk. Okay, so if I want to compute the power spectrum density of SE, there are two different components to xk, right? Okay, so let me go slowly. Okay, so this is going to be power spectrum density of did I get it right? Okay, so let me write this, let me do the simplification first, then I'll come to it. Just looking at the time, and I'm trying to figure out if I can do this properly or not. Okay, so let's write xk as what? Sk convolved with what? Xk is what? Sk convolved with hk convolved with dk. Okay, and then what? Plus. Okay, so I'm going to say nk convolved with dk. People usually don't write such things. I'm just writing it because I want to do the computation. Minus sk itself. Okay, so if you want to write this carefully, I can write it as sk convolved with hk convolved with dk minus what? Minus 1 for all k. Okay, so I'm going to call that 1 plus nk convolved with dk. Alright, so you make the assumption now that SK and NK are what? Independent random processes. okay, for all k they are independent. Okay, so once you do that, you'll see this random process is going to be independent of this random process. So if I have to find the power spectral density of E, I can find the PSD of this separately and then the NK process separately and then add the two PSDs, because the correlations will vanish. Okay, so whatever correlation terms you get will go off to zero, because I'm assuming the cross correlation terms go to zero. Okay, so that's a reasonable assumption to make. Did you have a question? Minus what? Oh, delta. Oh, sorry. Sorry. Okay. Sorry. It's okay. I mean, the PSD is one. Anyway, doesn't matter. So now, if you find PSD, right? This is not too bad to find. So if you do Fourier transform here, you get what? HD minus 1. Okay, and mod square of that is HD minus 1 squared. So you do that, you find your PSD very easily. Okay, so this becomes the power spectral density of S. Okay, what is the power spectral density of S? I'm going to assume it is IID uniform, right? So power spectral density will be flat. Okay, it will be equal to the variance of 1 SK. Okay, so that I'll call energy in the signal S. Okay, so what is this energy in the signal S? It's expected value of SK squared, assuming it is IID uniform, right? So it's basically what you've been doing, average square of your constellation. Modulus HD minus 1 squared plus what? Power spectral density of noise modulus D squared. Okay, is it okay? So this filter has response HD minus 1. So when the symbol process goes through that, it becomes ES times mod HD minus 1 squared. That's the PSD. And the PSD here is power spectral density of noise going through D, which is mod D squared. Okay, so this is the PSD. Okay, so you see the power spectral density of the error has two distinct components. One component which comes from the signal, another component which comes purely from noise, and they are additive. Okay, so remember, this is not just one number. Okay, so each of these guys are functions of e power j theta. Okay, so keep that in mind. So don't think of this as each just one number. So this is actually, I've dropped that e power j theta for convenience. Okay, so each of these guys are component for each of these. Is it okay? So now the problem is a simple algebra problem. It's a question of finding that D which minimizes SE. Okay, and you've written SE in terms of D, and H and ES and SN are constants for you. They're given to you. You can't change that. You can only change D to find the best possible SE or the lowest possible SE. It's enough if I minimize SE for each theta, right? The reason is I'm trying to minimize the arithmetic mean and it's non-negative real. So it's no problem. I can just minimize this thing for each theta and I'll get the overall minimum. Okay. So the trick to doing that is to do completing the square here. Okay. So this is some square time plus some other square. You go through and complete the square. But remember, all these guys are complex quantities. It's a little bit tricky if you're not used to this. But I'm going to give you the final answer. The final answer works out to, okay, so after you do the minimization, after completing of the square, the final answer will work out to, maybe we'll come back and derive this, SZ, okay, so final answer will involve Z, okay, so I'm going to call this ZK. No, not this. Oh my god. What is ZK? This is ZK. Okay, the final answer will involve SZ mod D minus ES SZ inverse H star. Okay, so H star square plus ES SN SZ inverse. What is SZ? SZ is the power spectral density of Z. Power spectral density of Z here will have two components. Very easy to write down. It's going to be SN plus ES times mod H squared. Okay, the reason I wanted to leave you with this is try to prove that the SE we had before is the same as the SE here. Okay, make an attempt, and we'll pick up from here in the next class.